you another example of some of the experiments that are underway as conventional journalism shrinks, but all these great communication portals expand. There's ways to kind of make mashups. This is a guy named Andy Bond, who is from Western Washington University. Last year, he and a team of researchers, including students from several different colleges, were going to Siberia to go float down one of those great Siberian rivers in a barge, doing research along the way that looks at how much methane can come out of the thawing tundra into the atmosphere. And methane is a powerful greenhouse gas. So I wasn't going to be able to go with them, nor did I want to, partially because all of those grains there that look like specks of dust on the negative, that's insects. Those are all mosquitoes and stuff. You don't want to be there, okay? So I was very happy for them to go. And what I said, though, is when you go, make sure you record some audio. I want to hear you guys tell me about what it's like. Take some pictures and send me some little dispatches. And we put together this postcard from the Pleistocene because they were looking at that last 2 million years of Earth history in the Earth beneath them. And it was a great success. And we're now doing the New York Times now on our science section has started a blog called Scientists at Work, where it's a place where you can follow scientists doing their work in their own words and pictures. So you'll see more of these kinds of mashups as we progress. That's why I don't think the death of traditional journalism is, you know, a terrible thing.
Oh, it's going to fix your sound.
Okay. I'll keep talking. Now, I throw this image in, set of images, because even though I've written so much about climate, and I'll talk more about it, as I wrote a year or two ago on the blog, climate is not the story of our time. Even though it's been portrayed for a number of years now, you know, the climate crisis, the climate crisis, the climate crisis. The crisis isn't out there, the climate. The crisis is in here. We are at this wacky stage, not only of our growth as a species, but our awareness of ourselves on this planet. And we only just, it's this weird conjunction of things happening right now. One is, we've become a planetary scale force. We're definitely changing the atmosphere. That will change the climate. Some of those gases are going back into the oceans in ways that are changing the chemistry of the oceans. We don't know all the impacts. We've changed biology. We're the biggest force driving natural selection on the Earth right now, by far. There was a paper in the year 2000 or so I wrote about. So we're moving species around like never before. The picture in the upper right-hand corner, I wrote about this a few years ago, Burmese pythons. So pythons from South Asia, these 20-foot-long constricting snakes. Some of them were let go in the Everglades by pet owners who tired of the idea of having to feed a rabbit to their 5-foot, 10-foot, 15-foot long growing python. They let them go, now they're running around the Everglades, well not running, but slithering around the Everglades, happily consuming all the wildlife there and breeding. They're now replicating. Henceforth, Burmese pythons are an indigenous species in Florida and possibly all the way up through Louisiana and around the Gulf Coast, eventually. So the python is just like the charismatic megafauna of the wearing blender of biology that humans become. Just think of the other end of the scale is pathogens, like the avian flu virus. I did a piece in .org about this amazing genetic analysis that was done a year or so ago, showing how that virus that didn't quite become an epidemic this past year or so, how the pieces of the genetic material in it came from poultry, pigs, and humans, and kind of, oh, they could actually chart progressively through time how that all became the thing that was running around airports and that kind of thing in the last year or so. So we're, again, biology is henceforth largely an artifact of our actions, intentional or not. And it doesn't surprise me, it's taken time for us to kind of really absorb and integrate this idea that the world, essentially, from here on in, is, well, at least for a good long while, as long as we're a planet-scale force, the world is increasingly what we choose to make it. And that kind of knowledge comes with a certain level of discomfort. And so it doesn't surprise me at all that some people utterly reject the idea. But the reality is that it's happening. This critter, this was the first time in all my journalism career I had to write the obituary for a species. You know, I haven't written a lot of obituaries. I wrote the obituary for the guy who invented Pampers, and for Jim Rodd, the Constitution Marsh, the head of that. But I never had to write the obituary for a genus species. And this was Baiji, the river gulf in China, in the Yangtze, that as far as scientists can tell, they don't exist anymore. It's very hard to prove the absence of something. There might be a couple lurking out there somewhere, but they're essentially gone. It took them 20 million years to kind of feel comfortable in that niche. And but now that niche has 400 million people living in it. The watershed of the Yangtze River is full of us. And it's not like people were going out there shooting for this animal. It just went extinct because it was fundamentally incompatible with all that human activity. And there's other stories about the other things, but I want to save some time. Now, and then the other reality, I kind of hinted at this before, is we, you know, again, why climate is not the only thing to think about in terms of energy choices. Along with the 2 billion people who don't have a light to read by, they also don't have anything to cook by except for an indoor, an unvented stove in their house. And that stain on that wall there in India gives you an idea of the toxicity of the stuff that comes from a cooking fire in an unvented, well, there isn't really an oven at all. It's just there. The smoke is with you. There's some weird paradoxes, like houses that have this kind of guttering cooking fire have a lot fewer mosquitoes. So they tend not to die of malaria as much, but they tend to die a lot of pneumonia and completely avoidable. And again, there's that flaw thing that could look at the whole issue. You know, if you just come in and say, oh, quick, give them clean stoves, and they start dying of malaria, have you made the problem better or worse? So that's why in so many of these arenas, having a broad view and keeping track of what is the overall question here, you know, human health and well-being. If you don't come in that way, you can actually make things worse. A big example of this was what happened with some pesticides in some parts of the world, where you banish things completely, and you know, many people died. Not just the pesticides in terms of malaria, but in terms of crop production as well.